you will, turn with me your Bibles to Psalm 42. We're going to read two psalms this morning, and that's because they probably went together to begin with. Verse and chapter numbers later added in. 42 and 43. We're going to deal with a tough topic, not because it's tough to understand what the Bible is actually saying, but it is tough because of what people experience. And what am I talking about? It's depression. Let me tell you, if you are a person who has problems sleeping at night, you are constantly worried that you have thoughts of death or even suicide, you need to go see a doctor. And in fact, if you have consistent thoughts of suicide, or you actually have a gun or drugs by your desk, I'd say leave now and go to the hospital. Because depression is rampant. And most people in one form or another have had depression for various reasons. It can be because of chemical imbalance. It can be because of the medicines you take to help treat whatever disease you may have, or you could be reacting to something that's happened to you. And to be honest, I went through a time when I was depressed. I mean, how depressed was I? The only thing I wanted to do is stay in bed and watch country music, and I hate country music. But it happened. It was the only time in my life I liked anything Shania Twain did. But that happened to me. So let's don't think that if you are depressed, you somehow are sub-Christian, because it happens. And the emotional well-being of a flock needs to take into account their psychological state, their spiritual state, the feelings of faith, which the psalmist goes into in detail, which is why I like the Psalms. So, while you may want to go see that medical doctor, also don't forget the spiritual advice that is given to us as David is really suffering. So let's hear what God's word has to say to us this morning in these two psalms. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they say to me continually, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul. How would I go with a throng and lead them to the procession to the house of God with a glad shouts and songs of praise, a multitude keeping festival? Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. My soul is cast down within me, therefore I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep at the roar of your waterfalls, all your breakers and your waves have gone over me. By day the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of my enemies? As with a deadly wound in my bones, my adversaries taunt me while they say to me continually, where is your God? Why are you downcast, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, my salvation and my God. Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people from the deceitful and unjust man. Deliver me. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of my enemies? Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then I will go my exceeding joy. And I will praise you with the lyre, O God, my God. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. Let's pray and ask God's blessing upon his word. O Lord our God, help us to see what David is going through, and help us to search for the spiritual wisdom that we need to take into ourselves so that we deal with our own thoughts, which may either be true or irrational. But, oh Lord, help us. Help us as there are those in this congregation who have, who are, and who will face depression. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Amen. Does the name Edmund Fitzgerald ring a bell? The Edmund Fitzgerald was a freighter on the Great Lakes. And on November 10th, 1975, he was carrying over 26,000 tons of pellets, which were going to be used in a blast furnace steel mills. And it was being battered by 30-foot waves, 90-mile-an-hour winds, and in the middle of the Great Lakes, it broke apart. You may have heard that name, Edmund Fitzgerald, from a famous song by the Canadian troubadour Gordon Lightfoot. And there's a line that has always stuck with me from that song. Does anyone know where the love of God goes when the waves turn the minutes into hours? You may not be aboard an iron ore ship in the Great Lakes, but you have all faced waves that have washed over you. So much so, I would guess that you have asked, where has the love of God gone? The waves that may be breaking over you are loneliness. It may come from that doctor's diagnosis which you have feared. It may be that you have moved to a new area and you don't know what is going on, or you have no friends. And when those storms arrive and God is distant, you may just be sitting and thinking to yourself, God is up there in heaven. He's sitting in a rocking chair and he is not concerned about me at all. Well, you are not the first person to ever experience that. If you look in the Bible, the prophets felt that way. Jeremiah, who was cast into a cistern and had the inglorious task of telling Jerusalem it needed to surrender. You have Elijah the prophet who felt that way. You have poets such as William Cowper felt that way, and preachers such as Charles Spurgeon felt that way. And it was for various reasons. They were depressed. And as we look at the Bible, if you ask me, David sounds pretty much like he's depressed. But I think the question before us this morning is, how do you deal with depression? Now, I am not getting up here and telling you what a medical diagnosis should be. I'm not telling you about the medicines you should take. I think there are other avenues for that. But let's not separate depression from spirituality, because they are combined. And this morning, the Bible is going to tell us how we are to deal with depression. Here's what it says. First of all, know what the experience of depression is. Second, set a resolution. And third, take strategies to overcome it. So once again, what is the experience? What is the resolution? And what are the strategies? To understand depression, you've got to know what experience is. Now, I'm not giving you an all-inclusive definition, but I want you to look at what David's emotional state is. And it starts in verse 3, where he says, "My tears have been my food day and night." Do you see what it's saying here? He's crying. He's weeping. And it's not just for 10 minutes. This is going on day and night. In other passages in the psalm, he talks about his bed being flooded with tears. He's not the type of person who has a stiff upper lip. He's not the person who's trying to tough it out. He's not the type of person who says, "Big boys, don't cry." No, he's not the frozen chosen. He's weeping. And it's going on, and it's going on. He weeps, he cries, he laments. And if you look at the section that's repeated in both Psalms three times, listen to what he's saying here. "Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me?" That's verse 5. He says it again in verse 11, and in the last verse, in Psalm 43, he says it over and over again. See what he's saying? He's almost, overcome with it, I guess you could say, of his emotional state of thinking that he's downcast, he's depressed here. He can't get his mind off of it. And that happens when you're depressed. You can't shake something. You try to forget it, but it comes back to you over and over again. And if you look at verse 7 here, for some of you, this may be a hard verse to figure out. It talks about deep calls to deep with the roar of your waterfalls. All your breakers and all your waves have gone over me. It is reminiscent of what Jonah went through when he was in the belly of the whale and he was upset. David is sort of saying, all my troubles are like waves that have come over me. And I'm drowning in trouble. He just can't get away from it. And in verse 10, he says, "As with a deadly wound in my bones, my adversaries taunt me." His body must feel worn out. He thinks God is abandoned. His body feels worn. He is weeping and God. And why has this happened? Well, we're given some clues here. Part of it, he just feels that God doesn't care. I mean, if you look at verse 2, he says, "My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God?" It's almost as if he's saying, I want to be with God, but I can't be with him for some reason. He feels abandoned by God, almost pushed away. And if you are depressed, that's exactly what you will feel, that God is not present with you. You may even think he doesn't care for you anymore. I'm not saying that's the reality. I'm saying that's what you perceive. And it's not just this spiritual isolation. He seems to be physically abandoned too, because he says in verse 5b, that he's remembering from the land of Jordan and Hermon from Mount Mizar, he is away from the worship of the living God. And notice over and over again, it talks about people taunting him day after day after day. No wonder he's depressed. He may have been king in Israel, but even kings have their foes, and this is what he's experiencing. As he's more than 150 miles away from Jerusalem, he's got his enemies, his body is breaking down, and he seems to be obsessed with his negative situation. And the same thing can happen to you. Sometimes, as life goes on, we may feel abandoned by our friends. We may have lived a long time, and our friends are no longer around. They've died off. One of the reasons that elderly people become depressed is because they've lost a spouse they spent a lifetime with. Dan Fogelberg had a song. It was called Windows and Walls, and here's one of the lines. No one comes by anymore. No one calls. The most, she just sits and stares at windows and walls. And in my mind, I can think of an elderly woman facing that day after day after day. It may be because you're in a new school and you don't know anybody there, and maybe they're making fun of you because you're a little different. You have a different accent. You don't know where to go, so you're depressed. Or maybe you've got a diagnosis from the doctor which you dreaded, and you know what the future will behold because of that. You may have lost your job. You may have had problems in your family, and your wife or your husband is ready to leave you. These things happen to Christian people. And the false view is that if you're a Christian, none of this will happen to you. None of this. Christians should never be sad again if we're really spiritually mature and we have a lot of faith. You won't have any problems. You will always, always be happy, and you will always be successful, and you will always have a smile on your face. It's not true. It's not true if you look at David. It wasn't true for Jesus, who wept over the loss of friends and having to go to the cross. I like what one theologian said. Under our modern smiles runs deep rivers of cynicism and despair. And in our day in which we try to take away all pain, we may not have the spiritual resources anymore to handle hardships and to survive when we are depressed. And it's because too often we think of the Christian life as a cruise ship with Richard Simmons and Kathy Lee instead of a wartime submarine, which you could see in the movie Das Boot, which is constantly under attack. Christian life is never going to be like a cruise ship until you get to heaven. Christians suffer, and Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 1:8, he's under affliction. Job, a man who suffered greatly, says this: man is born of a woman, is few of days and full of trouble. And I want you to think about your life. You can think of what has happened to you. You have not reached the level of success. You may have lost friends. You may go through conflict on a daily basis, and you may be depressed. That is the experience. So what's the resolution that we have to make? Well, you'll find it also in that section that is repeated over and over again. This is why I think David has a real problem here, because on the one hand, he's talking about his depression, but on the other hand, he's holding out something too. And listen to what he says. Right after he says, for example, in verse 5, why are you cast down on my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? He turns around and says, not once, not twice, but three times in this psalm, hope in God. For I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. You can see the same thing in verse 11 and the same thing in the last verse in chapter 43. And that hope means that you keep your eyes on God despite those circumstances. And over again, he says that. G.K. Chesterton once said this: hope means expecting when things are otherwise hopeless. It is looking at God even when things seem to be going down. David never gives up on that. It means that you have to trust God to deliver you one day. One person said this: if I stoop into a dark, tremendous sea of clouds, it is but for a time. I hold God's lamp close to my breast. It's sooner and splendor sooner or later will pierce the gloom, I will emerge one day. And I want you to think of the things that God's people went through in Exodus. It looked like they were trapped. God delivered. Joseph must have been discouraged and depressed by being placed in a pit, then in prison. But God lifted him up. Abraham must have been worried he never had a child. But eventually God provided. In Revelation it says God's people will go through tribulations, but one day he will deliver them. See, God will act. Either in this life or in the one to come, that pain will be taken away. And for most of us, it's going to be taken away what we go through in this life to some degree. We've got to think. We've got to realize that a lot of times we have irrational thoughts that just seem to bubble up in us. But this passage tells us God is the one who can ultimately deliver. Now let me tell you, hope is interesting. It's a struggle. But if you don't have hope that God can do something, what's your other option? There is no other option. If you don't have a sovereign God who is full of love and grace and mercy and justice, what else is there? What else is there? Cosmic chance? You think that's going to take away your problems? No. Only hope in the living God. Admiral Stockdale one time ran for the vice presidential candidate. He was 7 years POW in Vietnam. He was tortured. And afterwards, he walked with a limp. He was physically damaged. He was asked, how did he survive? His answer, he had hope. He had hope that one day he would go. And as Christians, we have to have that same hope. And as I look back on my life, there are situations where, yes, I was down. It seemed that I was out. But God relieved the burden. It may have taken a while, but the burden was relieved. And I got to tell you this. There's some things that I'll never get over in this life. I'm going to have limps because of what has happened to me the rest of my life. But one day, it's ultimately going to be taken away when I go to be with the Heavenly Father. That's the hope we have to hold on to. And once again, if you think that's just pie in the sky, what's the alternative? There is none. There is none. Chance? Someone else that you don't even know, are they going to take it away? No, it's not going to work that way. What you've got to focus on is what verse 8 says. By day, the Lord commands his steadfast love, his hesed, his pity, his mercy on his people. And even when I was depressed, daily there was mercy from the Lord. Well then, preacher, what daily strategies can I then use to help me overcome depression? Well, here's the first one. Remember the past. Look at verse 4. These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I would go with the throng and lead them in the procession to the house of the Lord with glad shouts and songs of praise. David is probably thinking back to other instances where God had maybe delivered him. Or he's thinking about how he used to worship the Lord. And for all of us, if we are honest with our life, we need to keep a record of the good things that God has done for us in a journal. And what we need to do is to write them down and remember them, because what's going to keep you going is the past instances of his goodness and grace to you. That's part of the reason we have memories. God has given us memories so that we will remember his goodness. As someone once said, memories are given so that we can have roses in December. Well, that's true. Sometimes it may be a letter that someone has written you. Sometimes it may be a comment from the past. Sometimes it may be an image that you have in your head of what it used to be. Remember, remember, remember the graces of God. Two, talk to yourself. Notice over and over again, David is talking to yourself. He's saying, "Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil?" Then he turns around and says to himself, "Hope in God." Here's what happens in the cycles of depression. You get up in the morning, thoughts come into your head. Where do they come from? Who knows? They may be reflections on what you've gone through, but these thoughts automatically come into our head. If you're going to overcome depression, you've got to fight against those negative thoughts. And the way that you can do this is by talking to yourself. And yes, that does work. In psychological literature, it's called cognitive therapy, but it's right here in the Bible. Tell yourself what God has done. Remind yourself and talk to yourself about the truths of God. Talk to yourself about the deliverance that He is going to bring. Talk, 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 not to others, but to yourself. No, we have seen people who are a little mentally off talking to themselves as they go down the hall. Talk to yourself in the same manner about the problems you face. And finally, remember Jesus. In verse 1, he starts out by saying, "As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God." Pictures of a deer who's being hunted, who needs water. In the New Testament, Jesus says, "I'm the waters." Jesus says, "If you're thirsty, come to me." Because ultimately, what we really need in life is Christ, who meets our needs for security and significance. And so often, people who are in trouble mentally, they don't want to trust in Christ. But it is Christ who can assuage pain that we feel by realizing that no matter what happens, I have a Savior who loved me, who died for me, and is coming back for me. So when you go through that time, when you're going down, when the waves seem to turn minutes into hours, you say to yourself, "Where has the love of God gone?" Remember to turn to Jesus. Have that spiritual thirst. And remind yourself, in one way or another, of the grace that He gives to all of us. Let us pray. O Lord our God, You are an awesome God. And we are feeble and frail, and so often we can fall into depression. Sometimes it's because of our bodies and the chemicals that we have to ingest, or it may be because of genetics and something's happened to us. Help us to see You as the one who can relieve that pain either now or one day. So be with us, Lord, and relieve the suffering of Your saints when they feel that they are washed up and washed out. Amen. Our final hymn is hymn number 404, "The Solid Rock That Stands Sound."